So can everybody hear me if I just talk like this?
Yeah.
Because that's the only option we have. Wow, thanks for coming out. This reminds me, like, my first teaching position, actually, so my career is varied, which is the beautiful thing about walking with the Lord, is you never quite know what He's going to do. And that's why it's so important to understand your own identity, so that when the road goes like this, you don't lose track of who you actually are. You can work in all kinds of environments if you know who you are. And you don't get your identity from where you are. You don't get your identity from circumstances that you find yourself in, and you don't get your identity from the people around you. I do not get my identity from my wife. She does not get her identity from me. My kids do not get their identity from me. And I do not get my identity from them. Therefore, we are free to be in this beautiful relationship together. There's no pressure there. So I wanted to say, when I went into the police department, I went out of college, went into the police academy, graduated from the police academy. The day I graduated from the police academy, actually, I was qualifying at the range, waiting to jump in the car as soon as I qualified to drive with my best man to Richmond, Virginia, to get married in the synagogue to my wife, which was an interesting process, because when I went to, when she came to Christ, my wife, Jewish background, so when she came to Christ, she was 19 when she came to Christ, and she went home and told her parents that she had become a Christian, and they were horrified. And then she went through that whole process with her family. It's a very difficult process. It took 10 years for her parents to understand what she meant. But not because of them, it took her 10 years to say it in a way they could understand what she was saying. She basically just offended them to death when she came to Christ. She just didn't know how to communicate what had happened to her, other than in the language of the Christians that taught her, right? She didn't mean to hurt their feelings. She just didn't know how to say it. So so we started going out. But before I went out with her, a couple of years after she had come to faith, a lot of years actually, so I was smart once or that time, and I decided to go ask her father for permission to date her. I've never done this before, but I was in a part of time in my life where I was really trying to figure out how to do things God's way. And so I wasn't very good at it, but I thought it'd probably be good to show her dad a lot of respect since he's Jewish and I'm not, and I want to marry his daughter one day, so I better start right. So he's quite a powerful attorney, her dad, and so I went to the city where he was, and I went to his office and met with him, and I introduced myself, and I said, you know, I go to university with your daughter, and I would like your permission to take her on a date. He said, you're kidding. You drove all the way here to ask me for permission to take my daughter on a date? She's like 22. What is this? The Waltons or something? Like, what are you doing? And I felt kind of dumb. And I said, yeah, but I just feel like I want to show you respect, and so I'm not going to take her out unless you say okay. He's like, all right, thanks for coming. Yeah, you can take her out. So then, later, I came back to him and said, can I marry your daughter? A couple years later. And he said, and it was her mom and her dad were together. I said, I want to marry your daughter. And her mom started crying. Bad sign. And then, I'm not kidding, her grandmother who was there said, ask me about Hitler. Because Hitler's a Christian. And I'm like, well, I wasn't prepared for that. How did I do that? And so her dad says to me, will you convert to Judaism? And I said, no. And he said, why not? And I said, for two reasons. One is because I'll never be Jewish in your eyes, ever. No matter what, I can go through the whole temple ceremony and the mikvah and all that. I'll never be Jewish in your eyes. He said, true. And I said, I would be making a mockery of Judaism by just going through the motion just so I could get your daughter. I said, that's fairly insulting and disrespectful, I think. I'd rather just stand on who I really am and just ask you straight out.
He's like, that is a good answer. Very good answer.
No. So, no. Okay.
So, I said, well, okay, so here's our options. I'm not going to marry her until you say yes, until you say to me that you bless this marriage. So I was 22, and I said, so that I'm not going to marry, I promise you I won't marry her until you say yes. However, I will come back and ask you every 6 months if I can marry her until you say yes or you die. He said, that is a very good position. You are in a great, he said, I really appreciate how well you thought this out, and I appreciate how much you respect me. And he said, yes, I can marry her. And he threw the wedding at the synagogue. And so I raced up there from qualifying at the range. We got married, and our life began together. And we've had an amazing life together. It's been like the craziest journey together. Living all over the world in the worst situations. So 27 years living in the Muslim world together. Our kids, when we moved to the first place, so I went to the police department, recruited by the CIA, moved away from the CIA, but I wanted to do what they wanted to do, so we had to work out a different kind of arrangement. I went to grad school. In grad school, I got a teaching position at the University of South Carolina, which was my first university teaching position, which was part of what I wanted to do overseas to counter terrorism. Then I went from there and I got a job working for the Indonesian government teaching in an Islamic university. 10 years in Indonesia we spent. When we moved to Indonesia, we went to teach in this Islamic university on a small island. We were the only Westerners on the island. When we landed there, which we didn't know until we landed there, there were 300 Saudi missionaries working on this island to make sure that the Muslims on the island were Orthodox. I had no idea that the Saudis, this is in 1990, I had no idea that the Saudis sent out missionaries. And they were good, and they were well-funded, and there were 300 of them. And we had our little team of teachers, three of us were professors, and we had met, the three couples, we had met in college, in grad school actually, and we were in a little prayer group together, and we started praying about where God wanted us in the world and this kind of thing, and we all decided, our little prayer group decided, let's just all go together. So one guy was an architect, one guy was a CPA, and I was coming from my background, and we were getting different graduate degrees, and then we all decided, let's all see if we can get employed by the Indonesian government, by Islamic government, and then get placed by the Muslims inside of an Islamic university. You know where we learned that strategy from? The strategy is let the enemy train us and pay us to win them. Do you know where we learned that strategy? From Moses. Who trained Moses how to raise up and lead a nation? The Egyptians. Who funded their movement? The Egyptians. We thought, well, that's good for Moses. Let's try it again. This is the difference between looking at the Bible like it's some kind of religious textbook and as if it's actually a strategy guide. And that you can actually do what they did in your own identity, in your own context, with a similar thinking style. So we tried it. So we were hired. We went into the situation. So when we landed on this particular island, our kids, we have three sons. Our three sons were 5, 3, and 10 months old when we landed on that island. The next time that our youngest son saw any relatives of his, he was 6. That's how long we stayed in this one place. Because we wanted to, we had jobs for one thing, but we were determined to to see what God would do among the Muslim population where we were living. So in that so we go into that situation, and we're all employed by the university there, the three of us. And my wife works for the New Zealand government in this situation where we're in. She went to work for the New Zealand government. They had a project going on this island. And so she went and began working under that project. We worked with the Australians. Like, we just found who was there already, and we went into work for what they did in our vocations, and we were paid for by the New Zealand government, the Australian government, and the Indonesian government. Pretty good gig, actually. And so we started that process. Our strategy in the university was this. We went to the head of the university, the Islamic University, and we said, look, what is your goal for your students? And they said, our goal is that our graduate students would be accepted in universities in Canada, the US, Australia, those places. The problem is, we've never had any students ever go to a foreign university in our history. And none of them can pass the Fulbright exam and those sorts of things. They just have never been able to do it. But that's our goal, that's our dream. So we said, we were waiting for that, we thought they'd say that. So we said, will you let us teach without putting Islamic internal police guys in our classes and keeping track of everything we say? Will you let us have freedom and not do that to us? They said, no, we won't do that. We will have those people in your class. And if you say anything wrong, we will arrest you. So we thought they would say that too. So we said, we promise you, we guarantee you, if you let us pick 20 students, grad students, men and women both, we have to have women. We're not going to discriminate between men and women. We have to have Muslim men and women in the class. Let us pick 20 grad students that we pick. Let us be in isolation with them for 3 months. And at the end of, and no, you don't monitor what we do. Don't ask the students what we're doing with them. Let us have them for 3 months. And at the end of 3 months, bring in any testing agency from anywhere in the world, and we promise you, we guarantee you, that 50% of those students will get full scholarships to Western universities. We guarantee it. If you do this and we fail, we will work the next 4 years for you for free. And they said, all right, if you're dumb enough to do that strategy, we'll take it. Now, where do we get that strategy from? Daniel, exactly. Daniel, the book of Daniel. That's what Daniel's strategy was, right? Leave us alone to do these things. Let us eat our own food, and we'll be the best students you've ever seen, even among your own people. We will be experts in your literature, the pagan literature. We will be better than your own people. But you got to leave us alone to follow our own way. So we thought, well, it worked for Daniel. I mean, is the Bible true or not? We think it's true. We think that's a pretty good strategy. Daniel's in a pagan captivity. He's an outsider. He decides that even though there's only four of them, that they can become the main influencers of the entire Babylonian Empire. How old was Daniel? What do you think? Six, yeah, 16. 10th grader came up with that strategy? Wow. Wow. We can't come up with that strategy when we're 40. How's a 10th grader coming up with it? You know, here's what Daniel knew. Here's what Daniel understood, and I guess his parents taught him this. Daniel realized when he was sold into captivity, he's humanly trafficked is what he is, so is Joseph. Joseph had the same strategy. Let's just take the thing over. Let's just win the whole place. It's a good strategy. You can either give up and complain, or you can become one of the main leaders of the people that took you captive. The choice is yours. So Daniel realizes that when he's taken captive, if you read that passage carefully, what's really being taught there is really brilliant, actually, is that the very first thing the captors are going to do, if you remember this, what do they do to Daniel and his buddies? What's the very first thing the Babylonians do? Makes them change what? Their names. Why? So they lose what? Their identity. That's right. The enemy always attacks your identity first. When Jesus goes out into the temptation,
We talked about this last night at our church. When Jesus is sent out to meet the enemy, the thing that the enemy, Satan, attacks in Jesus is his identity. If you are the Son of God. 3 times he attacks Jesus' identity. If Satan is attacking the identity of Jesus himself, whose identity was given to him by God, what do you think the enemy is going to attack in you? Your identity. The enemy always goes after your identity because once you lose your identity, you have no idea what to do. You have no idea. And all you're going to do is wander around asking people, what should I do? What do you do? Okay, I'll do that. How do you talk? Okay, I'll talk like that. How do you dress? Okay, I'll dress like that. All your identity comes from somewhere out here because it's not coming from here. It's not coming like this from God. So the Babylonians are smart, so they changed Daniel's name and the other three into Babylonian names of gods. And they try and rob their identity. Daniel is determined to maintain their identity. And how does he do it? He negotiates, remember, with the attendant that he can maintain their diet. That's the place where he holds on to his identity. He lets all the rest of it go, but he's like, if we can just stay separate from their food, eating what we eat will give us a sense of identity. This is how every intelligence service trains their people to survive torture, is to find one place way down here where you'll just keep giving little parts away, but there's one piece of your identity way down here that's small that they hopefully will overlook that you will never let go of. Because as long as you can hold your identity in place, you won't break. Any book written on torture, Natan Sharansky's great book is called Identity and Freedom, 10 Years in a Russian Gulag, is a refusenik for a Jewish refusenik. His whole book is the only people that survived in the KGB gulag were people that knew their identity. And he said the only people that knew their identity in the gulag were the uneducated Pentecostal farmers. No matter what the KGB did to those guys, they were always happy and held their identity. And all the super intellectuals broke. No sense of identity. Being an intellectual isn't an identity. Mostly it's false. So that's what we did. So we said, give us those students. They agreed. They gave us 20 students. We got the 20. We interviewed. We picked 20 grad students, had them in a room. They've never had a Western professor before. They're all Muslims. And so how are we going to make them acquire enough English in that amount of time to pass graduate level foreign testing? How can that be done? Well, you have to. It's kind of interesting. In linguistic theory, which is what we were using, we had a strategy that we built in grad school working together in linguistics and praying. And we were studying Krashen's theory of linguistics and Chomsky's theory of embedded grammar. And we're studying all this stuff. And we keep asking the Lord, what's another way to think about this? Chomsky is the greatest genius of language that's ever lived. What's something he hasn't thought of? That's fairly arrogant, isn't it? What's something that he's never thought of? And guess what? We thought of something that he hasn't thought of. You know why? Because we have the mind of Christ. That's why. And so we had an idea. Let's take Krashen's theory of affective filter as a hindrance to language acquisition, and let's transform that into a theory of sin and the Holy Spirit, and let's teach the Muslims how to lower their affective filter as if it's sin, so that the only way they'll realize that they can really acquire language more rapidly is if they're sinless. Isn't that brilliant? You're like, what? Okay, so? Here's Krashen's theory of affective filter. Krashen says that if you have a filter in front of you, it blocks your ability to acquire new knowledge. So the filter, and Krashen's, all of his experiments is, the filter can be depression, it can be anger, it can be anxiety. All these things prevent your brain from working fully. Fear, guilt, and shame, the main three hindrances to your brain acquiring new knowledge. Fear is the number one hindrance from mental development. That's why the number one exhortation in the Bible, said more times by God than any other exhortation, is do not be afraid. You know why the Bible is saying that? Because fear prevents your brain from moving out of the reptilian brain of my whole life is all about self-preservation and self-protection, which is the goal of most everybody's life, is just to protect and promote their own life. Is the lowest level thinking possible. Fear paralyzes you in that place mentally. So we realize if we could teach them to not be afraid of anything, they would acquire language like this. Anything we taught, they would acquire it faster. So what Crashen couldn't quite figure out is how to guarantee that that affective filter could be lowered. We thought we can get rid of the affective filter completely. How? Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit. Why not? So we brought the Muslims in the room. Our first lecture was on, what is the affective filter that's going to prevent you from getting these scholarships if you can't pass the test? It's fear, it's guilt, and it's shame. So we taught all in Indonesian, so we had to learn all this language. And so I'm teaching this, I taught the first class, and as soon as I start teaching, one of the girls, one of the women in the class, she raises her hand in Indonesian, she says, anyone here speak Indonesian, by the way? Yes, okay, good. Thank you. She says, dosa, right? What is that?
Sin.
That's what she called it. Oh, you mean sin, right? That's right. We're gonna teach you how not to have that. Because when you don't have that, then you're gonna be able to receive everything that we teach with an open mind, right? And so they're Muslims, they're like, okay, well, what's that involved? And so we taught how God takes away sin in the world. We taught it for 7 days. They listened to it because they were trying to figure out, wait a second. Okay, if Jesus takes away sin, and sin is what prevents me from learning language at a faster rate, and if I learn language at a faster rate, then I can take this Fulbright test or whatever, and I can get access to a whole new world of learning and opportunity, it seems like a good idea to know Jesus. Is it? Like, what if I stood up there and said, Jesus can keep you from going to hell? It's like irrelevant to him. No, Jesus can walk you into your true identity and walk you in that identity on into eternity in any way that he wants. And it'll be beyond what you can ask or imagine. That's inviting. Do you believe that about Jesus? Is that what he's doing in your life? It's like opening the Bible, like, man, that is the most brilliant strategy I've ever thought of. I love my quiet times. Or is it like, brother, what book should I read again? Like, it's boring. It's all about condemnation and sin and wrath. So we tried that. We thought, what can we lose? We'll have to teach 4 years with no pay. So we tried it. And so this is in 1990. We tried it. And then after 3 months or 4 months, Fulbright comes in to the university where we were, and they start testing all of our students. And they let me sit in the oral part of the testing with the students, because I wanted to hear how our students did. And so the Fulbright, so two men and a woman, Fulbright testers, are sitting there for the oral part, which is the most frightening part to our students, because, I mean, it's one thing to write the grammar demo, but to have to do an oral presentation with random questions, then the questions are not just concrete questions, but abstract questions. And they're a big question. This was Fulbright's big, we're gonna burn them on this. If they think they're good, we're gonna ask them this question. Here was their big question, because our students were doing pretty well. Here's the question. Okay, let's say you get a full scholarship to a US university and you're married, because all of our students were married. You get a full scholarship, you and your spouse go to where, Ohio State University, you're at the university, and your spouse doesn't like it there. And so they say, we're gonna leave, and we're not, you're coming with us. How do we know that you're gonna be able to work that out so we don't lose our money that we give to you? How are you gonna work out that conflict? And so in English, they have to explain how to resolve that conflict. Here's the thing. Americans don't know how to resolve that conflict. more than just a question of vocabulary, it's a question of we don't know how to resolve conflict, period. So how could we say it in a different language? But one of the ways they learned how to lower their affective filter was by resolving conflict between them and God. And the word they used, or the word they learned about how to resolve that conflict, is the word reconciliation. And so these Fulbright guys are, ah, what about that? And the first woman, she's in there, the first one of our students, she goes, well, we would have to enter into a process of reconciliation. And the Fulbright guy's like, what? The Fulbright guy didn't know what reconciliation was. He's an American. Reconciliation, what the fuck does that mean? So she has to lead him in understanding reconciliation. And she says to him, like, give me an example of something going on in your life. And he tells her about it. And she goes, well, you need to reconcile. He goes, I know. What are you talking about? Well, each of you have to think sacrificially. He goes, okay. And then she explains the process of reconciliation and sacrifice. He's like, you pass? You're going to some college somewhere. Out of the 2016 full scholarships, we were praying for 50%. The Lord's like, oh, you a little faith. So we become famous. In the Islamic University, like, whatever they do, stay away from them, leave them alone, don't bug them, let them do like that. Whatever they're doing in that room, do it. Keep doing it. And it's just like what happened to Daniel. We had so much favor that even when the Islamic extremists went after us, the university protected us. Wow. It was like, hey, don't come mess up this thing. Over your little religious beef, these students are excelling and our university is becoming known, and it's never been known before. Who is doing that? These followers of Jesus. It's only blessing us. They're not hurting us. That's how we started. So early on in our journey, we figured out this stunning fact. The Bible is actually true. It actually works on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday in the most critical times and the most high-pressure situations we've ever been in. It works. The reason I know most people don't believe it is because they think it's boring. Like, you must not be trying to do any of this stuff. Yeah. So we lived in that, so 10 years in Indonesia, and then after all of that time, we made lots of mistakes. I got arrested there. I did get put on trial there because the enemy is always after you, always after your identity. And he got me good. And so that happened. But 10 years in Indonesia, and then after that, we realized, wow, if this works here, how would it work in the iron belly of Islam? Let's go to the next level. So we moved to Baghdad in 2003 and 2004. We took the position in Baghdad in 2003 and 2004. So the whole thing that I want to talk about tonight is this issue of identity. So we have three sons and one adopted, but three biological sons. So let me just tell you, I just want to tell you about them because they're older than you, I think. The oldest one is 31, number two is going to turn 30, and the youngest is going to turn 28. So those are our three kids, and we have an adopted son that's 20, going to turn 29. Jordanian guy, kid, love Hamza. So our three sons. So about age, for me and Donna, about age 40, we started to realize we didn't really have a sense of our own identity in the kingdom. We knew how to do this, and we were like, let's read it, let's try it. So we were doing that, but then when remember this, you can remember this about God. God always wants to take you to eternal movement up with him into things that you have never thought about that will just wow you if you stay with them and don't give up. And so it's almost like, you know, Philippians talks about how Christ descended in order that we can ascend with him. And so once we start this upward journey with coming to faith in Jesus and the fullness of the Holy Spirit, and we start this movement sort of upward with him, vocationally, professionally, spiritually, all this journey up with him, he's always taking us up to the next level. In the Bible, the word content, to be content, when the Bible says learn to be content in all things, is only ever talking about material possessions. The Bible never tells anyone to be content in anything except when you're talking about stuff that you own. Be content. If you have nothing, be content. If you have a lot, be content. When it talks about spiritual maturity, the Bible says never be content. Never be content. So in my life, in Americans' lives especially, we're content spiritually with our level and never content about material possessions. We're upside down. We're living upside down. So growth that we think is going up is going down. Jesus flips us right side up and says, grow this way, be content with this nonsense down here, and never be content with this. Because this, if you seek first the kingdom, all this other stuff will be added. But this is what we're consumed with, all this stuff here like this. So God's moving us in this progression upward, and so every time we understand something deep about him, this is what he says to us. All right, here we go. You got that? Yeah. Here we go. And he loves to take us into places that we think are impossible. And the reason we know they're impossible is we're afraid to go there. So I say this all the time when I'm talking. Every time the disciples would tell Jesus what they were afraid of, he would make them go there. He would say to them, who do you not like? Well, we don't like Samaritans. Let's go. Where? Samaria. What? You don't like them? I know. That's why we don't want to go there, because we don't like them. I know. That's why you need to go there, because you're wrong. What else? Who do you not like? Gentiles. Let's go. In fact, then he shortens it. Like, tell me everything you're afraid of. Okay, we're afraid of hurricanes. We're afraid of Gentiles. We're afraid of graveyards. We're afraid of demons. And we're afraid of pigs. And you know, get in the boat. Where are we going? Into a hurricane and end up in a graveyard with a demon and pigs. Remember to be careful telling God who you don't like. We always say, if you're going to tell God you don't like someone, just say, well, I don't really know him. Because if you tell them that they're your enemy, then you have to love them. And we're good at saying who all our enemies are. That means you got to love a lot of people. So eventually the disciples figure this out. Man, if we say we're afraid of something, we're going there. And so when he says, what are you afraid of? Their answer is nothing. We're afraid of joy. Yeah, good. He says good because the way to joy is through suffering. So. So God wants you to live, this is what he wants. He wants you, he longs for you, this is his design for you, to live fearlessly in your true identity. That's what he wants for you. That's what he wants. If you will learn to live fearlessly in your true identity, you will win the world. You will bear much fruit. You will. Organically, it'll happen. Here's why it's not happening. It's because we're afraid. And we don't live in our true identities. We live in false identities. We do. So what's a false identity? A false identity is an identity that I receive, that I own, that I take on, that's not from God. There it is. That's a false identity. It comes from the world. It comes from my view of myself. It comes from the enemy. And I take that false view on myself, and I begin to live it out. Right? So our identity informs what behavior. So if I think I'm unworthy, I will live like an unworthy person lives. If I feel shame in my life, I will do what shameful people do. And most of what shameful people do is in secrecy and darkness. That's what you do. Unworthy people do things in isolation and in despair. Fearful people just don't do anything because they're afraid of everything. So identity becomes, fear becomes my identity. Shame becomes my identity. Unworthiness becomes my identity because someone said to me, yeah, you're not very good at that. When I'm a little kid, I'm like, oh, really? Yeah, that's true, I'm not good at that. And you shouldn't, you're probably not gonna make this group, so. I'm like, ah, why am I not gonna make it? And the enemy's right there to help you. Because you're a loser. Like, is that hard for you to see? And we're like, ah, yeah, I know that, I can see that. Because whenever the enemy speaks to you, it takes no faith to believe what he says. Listen, whenever the enemy talks to you, it takes no faith to believe what he says about you. You are not as good as them. I know, I know. We believe it right away because it's, yeah, well, it's true. You are a terrible student. Look at your grades. Yeah, I know. So that's what we are. That's what we become. False, 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 false. So here's the progression. God, when we meet with him, he moves us from the false self into the real self. The real self tells the truth. The false self just lives in lies all the time. I know God works everything together for good, and I hate myself. All these Christian cliches. All these cliches. Man, I was sitting in a thing and another city downtown in this inner city thing, listening to these people talk, and I was just writing in my notebook, cliché, cliché. Everyone's just saying clichés back and forth to each other. All these Bible verses, clichés. Like, does anyone believe this stuff? Is anyone saying anything that you believe like that? So we live in this world that's not true. So in this world, my view of God is that he's mad all the time. He has to be mad all the time, and he must be mad at me. I must be a sinful, disgusting rag to him, because look at how I view myself. How do I see myself? I see myself as sinful and wrath. I deserve wrath. The real self comes over here and says, wait a second, wait, wait, wait. What's true is I'm afraid. There's the truth. What's true is I feel ashamed of myself. What's true is I feel, God, I feel unworthy. This is called confession in the Bible. Confession is not saying you're sorry. Nowhere, the definition of confession is to, in the Greek, is to say the same thing again, to agree. So when a police officer arrests someone and says, here's the sheet, I need you to confess so we can get this thing cleared up. And you write, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. I wrote, I'm sorry, 1,000 times. What is that? We need you to tell the truth about what happened. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Who told you that saying you're sorry is confession? Who told you that? Oh, you know who told you that? See? Confession is telling the truth. Here, I'll confess in front of you. I confess that I'm an American citizen. That's a confession of truth. There it is. I confess it's true. I'm not sorry about it. Confession is telling the truth. Here's another confession. Most of the time, I feel unworthy. What does God say when you say, God, I feel unworthy? What does he say? Well, you oughta. Is that what he says? Wow. Is that what Jesus would say to you? Is that what he says to people that feel unworthy? Jesus, I feel so unworthy. Jesus, I don't believe. Help me in my unbelief. What does he say? Tough. That isn't what he says. Good, good, good. Confession leads to repentance. Repentance is God telling you the truth. Confession is you telling God the truth about what you believe about him and yourself and the world, the truth. I hate those people, Lord. I'm afraid of those people. Stop pretending that you like them and that you pray for them. It's a lie. God, give me the nations as an inheritance you promised. Okay, open up your house to Muslims. And my next prayer is, God, give me the nations out of here. Okay, move to the end. Okay. And the next thing, like, it's a lie. It's a lie. Tell the truth. truth liberates. Truth always sets free. Even hard truth, even real truth. God, I don't love those people. I'm afraid of them. They hurt my family, and I don't think I can love them. Help me. That's confession. That's beautiful. And Jesus always moves in confession. He's always right there. Okay, I'll walk you through this. I can transform that. False self into the real self. Confess, tell the truth. If we confess our sins, our separation from God, our falling short of, if we confess them, He is faithful and just to forgive them. Forgiveness in the Bible is an accounting word. It's not an emotional word. It's an accounting term. Jesus talks about forgiveness as a debt being forgotten, cut off. If we tell the truth about where we've separated ourselves from God out of fear, guilt, and shame, He is faithful to cut off the fear, guilt, and shame from us and set us free into righteousness. Nowhere in it, I'm sorry.
You should be.
That's not what's happening. This is a transaction, a legal transaction based in accounting terms and juridic terms. Do it! Tell the truth, get it cut off, have the debt taken away that you can never repay because Jesus paid it for you. You are free, walk free, be the true self. Be who He made you to be. Wow, when you step into that true self, then you're like we were saying today, then you're like Saul of Tarsus becoming Paul. Then you're like Peter, like this. I'm not for you, I'm running away from you. I'll defend you, I'm not defending you. What is that? Why don't you act like a rock? Why do you act like this lunatic that says all these things that aren't true? Peter's a liar. I will never leave you. You're a liar. Why do you say this nonsense? Jesus doesn't want him to say this stuff. Who is he trying to prove it to? His own fear. Think about this for a second. Think about this. Peter denies Jesus, right? He denies Jesus. We all know this story. He denies Jesus 3 times, all this stuff. He's warned. Peter, who Jesus says, Peter, who do you say that I am? Peter's like, you are the Christ, you are the anointed one. Jesus is like, wow. Flesh and blood didn't tell you that. Those are the words of the Father. Four verses later, don't go to Jerusalem. Jesus, we can't have Christian persecution going on. We've got to stop this persecution thing. You're being falsely accused, and that's not God's will in the world, that Christians be falsely accused and punished and suffer. That's not His will. Don't go. Jesus is like, you're not speaking the words of the Father suddenly. Now you're speaking the words, who does He say? Of Satan, that bastard. That's not a rock, that's a words of the Father and Satan. Wow, that was fast. Like in chapel, you were speaking the words of the Father. Outside the chapel, the words of the enemy. True identity and false. That fast. So he denies, you know, he's warned, he denies, he fails. We all fail. John 21 is the reenactment when the first time Jesus teaches him how to catch fish. John is doing it again. Because Jesus will do the lesson again and again with us because He loves you. How many times does He have to teach the lesson? He'll do it again. He'll do it as many times as He needs to for you to walk in your true identity. So He's with Peter. They're in the boat. They catch the fish. John jumps out. You know, Peter jumps out. John's like, I know it's the Lord. John's always the first. You know, I knew before Peter that it was the Lord. It's like, why? Why do you have to say that, John? Why do you does that? John does that. Do you notice that about John? Did you even call John the Beloved? John. I don't think I would like John. He's like, you know, I'm the Beloved. Can't you see the other disciples going? Don't have the Beloved over there. You know, even when they run to the tomb, John has to say that he got there before Peter. Yeah. But now it's the inspired word of God that I won that race for all time. Wow. Anyway,
So Peter is back with Jesus. Okay, so here comes the restoration. You know this story. Okay, so Jesus is going to restore Peter into his true identity. How many times in that story does Peter say he's sorry to Jesus? How many times? Never. How many times does Jesus say to Peter, you really need to apologize about this? How many times? Never. Never. Why? How do you restore someone that doesn't apologize? How can they be restored if you don't tell them, hey, you need to confess this right now? What happened there? What happens in that interchange? So here's what Jesus says to Peter. Here's what happens. He says, Peter, let me ask you a question. Do you unconditionally love me like you always say you do? Do you love me more than everyone else like you always say you do? Do you agape love me? Peter's like, in his old self, he would say, yes, more than any, they'll leave you high, mom. That's the false Peter. That's the denier. It's not who Peter really is. The real Peter says to Jesus, you know what? I only love you like a brother. That's his answer. I phileo you, I only love you like a brother. It's probably the hardest thing Peter's ever said to Jesus in his life. You know why? Because it's the truth. I don't love you more than everyone else. I don't love you with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. I just kind of love you like a brother. It's like all I can do. And Jesus is like, go teach my people. This is you. This is the truth. You go teach like that, like truth. Do you really not agape love me? Do you not agape? No. No, second time. No, I only phileo love you like a brother. Leave my people. Go. Leave my people just like this and treat the real you, the true you. Go leave like that. Last time, Peter, let me ask you one more time. Do you really phileo love me? Jesus drops the level. You don't have to brag to me. You don't have to make all those false claims to impress other people. Tell me the truth. Do you really phileo love me even? And Peter, for the first time, you know my heart. This is the true me. You look inside me. Hurt his feelings. Look at my true heart. I love you like a brother. I do. I have that much in Jesus. Like, there you go. Beautiful. Go be the rock. Go do what you were always made to do. Lead my people. But do it in the true you, not this false. What do we do? How do we talk in this false, like I gotta prop it up? I'm really bored out of my mind here, but I'm gonna pretend like I'm excited. Or in the true, God, I'm bored out of my mind. What's going on? Transform me, help me. I've lost my love of you. It's buried somewhere down in religion. Where did I lose it? That's confession. And Jesus is like, I'll help you find it. I'll lead you in the way everlasting. Repent. You come with me. We'll turn and go the true way, the real you. Turn and let's go the new way. Now that you've told me the truth, I'll tell you the truth. You're made to love me at a level you don't even know yet, but you got to tell the truth all the way. Because truth will set you free. You can only do that in your true identity. That's where God, Jesus, will never meet you in a false identity. Do you know why he won't? Because it's not real. That view of yourself is not even there. It's not true. It's false. You are not filled with shame. You are not unworthy. He made you worthy. How can Jesus talk to an unworthy person that he died for? He died to make you worthy. To talk to you like you're unworthy means his death didn't work. How dare you say that to him? How dare you come to him like his death didn't help you? So when Jesus is talking to people in the Gospels, he talks to them, listen, in their true identity all the time. Read the Gospels like this. He talks to people in the identity that they were made in their mother's womb, and he won't talk to them in false identity. Even though they come to him in false identity, will not acknowledge it. This is one of the great things about the Gospels. It's stunning. It's breathtaking. No other religious book has this. The prostitute crawls in on her face to Jesus' feet. And Jesus looks at her, and here's this question. Why are you acting like a prostitute? Why are you? Jesus doesn't call her a prostitute. Who calls her a prostitute? This is what makes Jesus upset. Who calls her a prostitute? In that story, who calls her a prostitute? There's several people. Who calls her a prostitute? The Pharisees, the religious experts in the Bible, because they're there to judge everyone. She's unworthy. The wrath of God is on her. Thank God it's not on me. Thank goodness I'm not like her. This is how they talk. This is called false identity. Hey, you think you're better than her? Lie. You think God loves you more than her? False. But that's what we think. They call her a prostitute. They name her that identity. She calls herself a prostitute. That's the most tragic. She calls herself a prostitute because the men she sleeps with or pay her call her a prostitute. I guess she might know some of these guys professionally. I wouldn't be surprised, since we're all just going to lie. Everyone calls her a prostitute, except the only one that has the authority to actually make that call. And you know what he calls her? Daughter. Wow. Here's his question to her. I'm confused. Why is my daughter acting like a prostitute? Why is that? Here's what I want you to do. I want you to stand up. Forget these idiots. I'll take care of them, believe me. I want you to stand up. I want you to walk out of here and live like I made you to live. You're my daughter. Act like my daughter and stop falling short of the glory of how my daughter lives. Good luck. See you. That's it. She doesn't say she's sorry. He doesn't yell at her. Act like what I made you, and you can do that in relation to me. Go live that way. Go, daughter, and do what daughters of the king do. He doesn't have to tell, now tomorrow we're going to do these three things. Do what my daughter does. What's that? Whatever my daughter does. That's how Jesus doesn't talk to lepers like they're sick. He talks to them like they're well. He talks to blind people like they can see. Isn't that interesting? And he talks to people that think they can see like they're blind, because they are. Because he only tells the truth. You are blind. And this guy that you think is blind can now see, can't you?
Yes!
I don't know of a more beautiful book than the Bible. I just don't know. I've never read anything like this. It promises this kind of transformation. To live in your true identity, that God sent his son into the world, not to condemn the world. Be careful. Not to condemn the world, that the world through him might be rescued. To be what he intended us to be, his children, his people. Is that how you live? Is that how we live? And is that the message that we're taking out here? Can you say one more thing?
That was maybe I won't say one more thing.
One more thing. One more thing. When you understand this about yourself, when you understand your identity in the kingdom, you are able to lead other people into understanding their true identity. It's called sharing your faith. That's what it's called, sharing your faith. Announcing the kingdom, the euangelion. Announcing the good news of the kingdom. You, who were lost in a false identity and separate from God, can now come into the kingdom, stand upright in the aliveness of God, and live in your true identity. And do what? Whatever you can ask or imagine in your true identity, go do it. Where? Anywhere. Doesn't matter. Your identity can go anywhere with Christ. So, if I understand that, and I know how that works in me, this is called abiding in Christ, by the way, is how Jesus terms it. Abiding in Christ, just to make it simple, comes like this. We say it like this. Abiding in Christ has four A's, just for our own practice. Abiding in Christ means we pay attention to God. You're paying attention to what he says, not what anyone else says.
What do you say is happening in this situation? God, what do you say is happening in this situation? Not the news, not the Christian media, not the Muslim, nobody. What do you say? That's called paying attention to God. All learning requires attention. If you're not paying attention, you miss everything. Attention leads to awareness. If I'm paying attention to God, I become aware of way more things than what I am in my own little narrow view of things like this. So attention to God makes me aware. It raises my level of awareness of Him, myself, and others. In that place of being suddenly aware, wow, I'm aware of it. I'm aware like you guys are in trouble. I'm aware God is telling me something about myself that I don't know, and I'm aware that I don't know. All this awareness goes on, and in that awareness, God can give annunciations. Attention leads to awareness, which leads to annunciation or communication because I'm paying attention to what God is saying. When you pay attention and are aware of what God's doing, you can hear what He's saying. In the spirit, in the world, in the community, you can hear it. The Beatitudes, which I think is a progression, says, blessed are the pure in heart. The pure in heart means singleness of mind, has nothing to do with morality. Pure in heart means there's nothing in my heart except what God has for me in my own identity. Pure, no distraction. Blessed are the pure in heart, because what can the pure in heart do? See God. Oh, that's a nice little coffee cup poem. No, that's actually real. Jesus says it. I only do what I see the Father doing. But we know that Jesus set aside His divinity when He came down to earth. How can He be 100% human and see what God is doing? Like, well, how is that possible? He has the mind of God through the Holy Spirit. I can see what God is doing in the situations where God has put me in my identity and location. God, what do you want us to do in this university, this Muslim university that's never been done before? We don't have anything to copy. Where can we see what you're doing? We look at the word. Oh my gosh, I can see this here. In this situation, yes. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And the next, once I can see God, peace. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the, for they shall be called the children of God. And once I'm at peace because I can see God and what He's doing in my own life and the situation I am, I'm at peace all the time. I'm not afraid. And once I'm at peace, blessed are those who are persecuted, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Because when I'm at that kind of peace, persecution can't affect me. Because my peace doesn't come from what's happening to me. It comes from my relationship with God. Once you know that, once you get that, once you can start living that out disciplined in the disciplines of the faith, then you can teach another person how to do it. You know how fast you can do it? Like this. So our team, I'll just give you one example. I can think of a thousand. It's so hard to. So our team in a Middle Eastern country, we had a young team, and we were asking God, is there some way to share our faith that we don't know yet? Have you ever asked that question to God? Is there a way to share our faith that just hasn't been done yet that would be really awesome to know? Why would we not try and think of new ways to share our faith? Is it a sin? Is there only one way? Well, we thought we'd just ask Him. Right? That's a good test. Lord, is there another way to share our faith? We're reading the Bible. We're praying together. We're like, I wonder if God, in the Bible we see God communicate things to people that without a person really explaining to him, God can communicate it to him. So let's try that. So let's, God, if we bring Muslims together and we pray with them in our faith, will you speak to them before we even get started? How would you know that? You try it. Kind of the rule in this world, if you want to know something, you try it. So we said to our young people, because they're young, they'll try anything. They don't know they're not allowed to do this stuff yet. And so, like, hey, let's do this. Let's just ask God to lead us to Muslims in the community who are people of peace and just see if they'll come back and be part of a prayer thing. Why?
Fear.
That's right. Exactly right. And here's Satan going, boy, that's the stupidest idea I've ever heard in my life.
that is so stupid. This is going to blow up in your face. You're going to look like idiots. And then we stop. Oh, yeah, that's true. It'll probably blow up in our face. Faith is the substance of the things we hope for. Faith is the evidence of the things you don't yet see. Well, I don't need faith for what I already know how to do. I want a faith for the things I hope for. What do we hope? Is there a faster way to share our faith with these people so they can come to Christ quicker? So we can speed this thing up? Is it possible, God? Can we do it in honor of you? Because we love you so much. And is there another way to do this at a deeper level? Let's try it. So one of our young guys is out there in the city and he calls me. He's like, hey, Jamie, I met a guy. I think he's willing to come and pray. And I'm the senior person. He goes, can I bring him over and let's just pray with him and see what God does? Yes. All right, we're coming. Incoming, here they come. And so this guy comes to our house. His name is Omar. He's 34 years old, very committed Palestinian nationalist. So not just a Muslim, but very nationalistic on the Palestinian cause. Pretty much dislikes everything about America, Israel, all of that. Perfect. That's the kind of guy you want. He comes over. We're sitting, talking, drinking tea. He says to me, Mr. Jamie, I met Andrew over here at this embassy, and we're talking, and I asked him his view of Jesus, Andrew. And Andrew said, well, I can tell you my view of Jesus, or you can come, we can come together and ask God his view of Jesus, and you can hear God say the view of Jesus even before we say it. And my, because Andrew's young, and it's his first time out there, he goes, and my friend Jamie will do it. All right, okay. So I'm like, okay. And so Omar asked me the question, what do you think I should know about Jesus? And I said, I'm happy to tell you what I think you should know about Jesus. But what if God told you what to know about Jesus? Wouldn't that be me? You can hear me or God. Who do you pick? He's like, well, I don't want to be disrespectful to you, but are you saying that God will speak to me about Jesus? And I said, that's what I'm hoping. Yep. And yes, I think we have precedent for this. Yes. And I said, and the only way we'll know is, like, let's just ask him, right? See, here's what's important. I don't get my identity from whether this works or not. Do you understand that? My identity comes from God. This is what God says to me. You are mine, and I love you, and I'm proud of you. That never changes. And God likes it. Like, we're going to try, Lord, we're going to try this and see if this brings you glory. He's like, all right. Like, try it. I'm going to burn you on this. Like, I don't think he would say that. So we're like, okay, so what we're going to do is pray with you. It's called discipleship, really, is what we're going to do. We're going to disciple him in prayer. So what we're going to do, we're just going to put him on the accelerated course. And so we're going to pray. So he goes into the bathroom. He washes. Okay, all right, we wait. He comes back out. Okay, we have a carpet there, so he's comfortable. He kneels down on the floor. We kneel down on the floor with him, but Andrew on this side, me on this side, just so he's comfortable. Do you have a problem with kneeling to God? Wow, how long did it take you to go? No, I don't have a problem kneeling with God. Yes, we kneel before God. I kneel next to Omar. Omar bows and puts his head on the ground, and I put my hand on his shoulder, and I say, Lord, this is my friend Omar. Omar has a question. His question is, how is he supposed to understand Jesus? In what way is he supposed to know and understand Jesus? We want Omar to know Jesus. We do. We know Jesus. We can tell Omar about Jesus. But God, out of your kindness and mercy, because Omar doesn't think you speak, would you just, out of your concern and love for him, not because we are righteous, but because you are merciful, God, would you just speak to him out of your compassion? And we will just wait for you, Lord, to do whatever you want. And then nothing, we don't say one other word. How do you wait? So think of the Bible. People pray prayers. How long does it take for God to answer? Maybe 21 days. Because Michael's got to fight. I don't know. We're testing. I don't know. I don't know. So we have our heads down like this. But I'm looking at Omar, so I'm not really bad. And all of a sudden, I can just feel Omar, his body shaking like this, and he's sobbing. He's like weeping, like bouncing like this. And Andrew's head pops up like. Don't ruin this, Andrew. He's bubbling this, and then and he's just weeping his eyes out. Now, what do you think that is? What do you think's happened? Just take a guess. What do you think's happened? Yeah, something's cutting right through to his heart. And so he sits up and he takes his glasses off. This guy has a master's degree in political philosophy or something. He's wiping his glasses off and the tears are running down his face and he's kneeling and we sit up with him and just looking at him and he's not looking at us. He's just got his head down and wiping his glasses and I said, "Are you okay?" He said, "Yeah, yeah." He goes, "Wow." He goes, I don't know what happened." And I said, "Well, can you tell us what happened?" He said, "Well, I don't understand it." He said, "When you asked God to speak to me about Jesus, I saw myself as an infant lying in like mud or dirt. And the Christ, that's the name he called Jesus, the Christ. The Christ came and lifted me up and washed me with water and told me that I had to be born again. What does that mean?" I'm like, I said, "Have you ever read the Injil?" And he goes, "No, I find it to be corrupt." And I said, "Well, I think you're going to change your mind because I have a story to show you." So we get back up on the couch. Look how beautifully God ties his word and his spirit and his people together. Get back up on the couch, open up John 3, story of Nicodemus, I hand him the Bible. He reads the story, he's reading it through, and he bursts into tears again. He's just sobbing like this. You know, it's like when we read the Bible. It's so powerful, moving. And I like put my hand on his shoulder and said, what's the matter? And he goes, "I am Nicodemus." He goes, "I'm a man, I know my religion. I know my religion, but I don't know what it means to be born again. And I don't know Jesus like this. And this is what I want. I want to be born again like this." He was our first believer in that city. And you know what that made us want to do? It made us change our view of evangelism. And we ran out into that city to find people to pray with. Because we realized that God is greater than our strategies. And he loves to wow us, and we worship him because of what he does. It made me and Andrew and our whole team worship Christ like we had never done that thing. God, do you love people this much? You love me that much, you love him that much, and we just worshiped. And God's always like, "You think this is great? This is great. Just, that's what he has for you guys. I don't even know how. The beautiful journeys will be unique to you, but it will be consistent with his word and with his spirit, and in this community of believers is where the balance is." And that, Omar and those Muslim guys that came to Christ, there are a movement today of more than 10,000.
Wow.
Yeah. So many Muslims come to Christ.
Hey,
yeah. Yeah. Don't you want to be a part of that? I do. I want to see this in Portland.
Yeah.
I want to see it. This has never been seen in the United States among Muslims. That's a sad commentary. The one place where they're free to hear the gospel and free to believe without persecution, pretty much no movements of this. That's our fault. Okay, I'm done. Thank you very much. You can ask me questions. Whatever you want to do. Thank you.